Ladies and gentlemen, Lou Simon.
Well, welcome. Welcome to the Baked Potato, an intimate and wonderful and legendary jazz room in Studio City, California. Listeners all across America, here we sit with royalty and a bunch of dedicated 60s on 6 listeners and 60s music fans who are quickly learning that everything it said on the label didn't tell you everything about what went on in the studio. Today we're going to celebrate the Wrecking Crew, a name that was, after the fact, kind of retrospectively given to a group of elite musicians in Los Angeles who were, as we just said a moment ago, the honest backbone of the records, and so much more. And it is all in a new documentary, which is must-see, simply called The Wrecking Crew. And we're here to celebrate the making of that and the story behind it. As the announcer just said, we have some highly esteemed players here. Chuck Berghofer is a jazz man, as far as I'm concerned, but he probably along the way quickly figured out that there was some money in the 2.5 minute pop single and made himself available and played on incredible records. And the, you know, we just in that open said Nancy Sinatra, but you didn't hear her sing. All we played was a bass run, an upright bass lick. Chuck Berghofer. He, you know, I'm sure, Chuck, that, you know, you're tired of your entire career being, encapsulated in a 20-second run, but and we'll talk about all the other things you did, but you know what? You did it well. And watching the documentary, I heard Nancy say how difficult it is to play that properly. And, you make it sound so simple, but apparently it's a challenge for other musicians.
For other bass players, not for him.
Not for him. Well, right. Also, here is a keyboard man whose name I first noticed on a Mothers of Invention album, a Frank Zappa record. And he just told me the story of how that happened, and we'll have him repeat it. But there's so much more to Don Randi and Nancy. Again, back to Nancy, said she and Lee Hazlewood wouldn't make a record without him. A highly respected keyboard man in many genres. And by the way, one of the, he's the founder of the club we're sitting in, the Baked Potato. Don Randi is here. And then we had an extra chair, and they said, we can get you this guy. And I said, you know what? He's an okay drummer, but what the heck? Ladies and gentlemen, the most important percussionist of our generation, Hal Blaine.
It's a small world.
And I want to begin by speaking with the other guest that we have, who is not one of the legendary musicians, but his dad was. Tommy Tedesco was a premier, first call, must-have guitarist. Who mastered many styles, which is why he lasted so long and did so many genres and then taught master classes and was just a consummate musician. And somewhere along the line, we'll ask this question, Denny decided to tell the story. I don't know if his dad asked him to. I don't know how it happened. But Denny, you've done a remarkable job of teaching us about your father and, in turn, all of his cohorts and this marvelous story. And it was not an easy movie to get released, and we're going to talk about that as well. Your mom, Carmi, is here, and yeah. I'm going to put words in her mouth and say she is as proud of your accomplishment, your tenacity, and the result as she is of her husband's incredible guitar playing. And so thank you very much for what you did
thank
for
you.
All of us. I want to start with that story. Tell us a little bit about your dad's journey. It's in the movie, so we all get to see it there. But because it's interesting, you know, a lot of these players, as I watch the documentary, have Southern accents. Joe Osborne, Leon Russell. These guys came here in some kind of a Western exodus to find work, etc. But what about your dad? Where was his roots?
Dad and my mom, born in Niagara Falls, New York. There's actually a city there, would you believe it? But they were, dad was working, I think mom was a chemical factory somewhere that, along the river. And 1953, they were invited to a dance at Niagara University. And they went to the dance, and the big band there, Ralph Martiri Big Band, was losing a guitar player the next day, and someone found out, and my dad auditioned that night. Got the job, got on the road, literally the next day, and went around the country, got to Hollywood, they did the Hoagie Carmichael show and all these great things out here. He saw what it was like out here. They got to Dallas, and he got fired. It was downsizing the band. They got a singer who could play guitar and sing. So he and the other guy got fired. And my dad did not want to go back home. He didn't want to go back to Niagara Falls and just, you know, get the look, that evil eye of like, oh, you messed up, you know. So he got my mom and my older brother, and they moved west. They went to Hollywood. And I recently asked her, I said, was two things. I asked her, how long was it before you guys moved to L.A.? Was it a year, year and a half? She goes, no, 3 weeks. she said, we sold the furniture from our wedding that we still owed on. And she said, and then I asked her, I said, well, was Dad gigging a lot? She goes, there's no gigs in Niagara Falls, New York for music.
And so this was a monstrous risk to come out here then.
I think it was escape. I think that's what he, thank God. But then this is the best part. She goes, I said, there was no gigs. She says, no. She says, he didn't want to go to that dance because he actually got a gig in Pennsylvania and with his trio. And he was fighting with her. I don't want to go to the dance. I got a gig. She goes, you have to go to the dance. I spent $35 on this dress. So that $35 dress changed life for me and a lot of other people.
We're going to talk about what the life was like, because something else that's very notable in the documentary is that home lives, in some ways, suffered a bit. Someone says, might have been your dad in a voiceover, I was a better grand. I'm a better grandfather.
No, that's Plaz. Plaz Johnson.
Oh, Plaz Johnson.
My favorite line in the movie.
I'm a better grandfather than I was a father. So we're going to talk about that. But that was his journey west. Just a quick question. Did he ask you to in any way document the story?
Not at all. When Dad was diagnosed with cancer in 95, 96 it was, I just knew I didn't want that to be something I would regret the rest of my life, not to tell that story about these guys.
Did you make a promise to him? Was there any?
No.
So
no, it's weird.
So he passed without knowing.
It's an interesting question because I've never been asked that. And I just said, Dad, this is what I want to do. He said, okay. And he was there. He said, you know, and I said, who do I get? You know, he said, well, you should talk to Hal and Don and Chuck and all these guys and, you know, and just go for it. But he was there to support, you know, in any way he could support me. The saddest thing about, for those who have seen the doc, I was shooting film at the time, and so Dad was in 96. We shot that scene around the round table. The problem with shooting film, I didn't get to my dad to do a solo interview until months later, and by then he was too weak. And that was the saddest part for me.
Well, not luckily, you had the footage from the Musician's Workshop.
Oh,
you were able
to
use that.
Which is phenomenal.
Great. Well, if you haven't seen the movie, any of our listeners, you must, and you'll see, and this will all make a lot more sense to you. But Don, are you from L.A., or what was your journey?
My journey was, I was a young man in 1954 who was asked by the state of New York to leave the state of New York. And my poor music teacher had it set up for me at NYU and at a couple other schools to study music. And, of course, I had to come to California with my mother, and I went to Los Angeles Conservatory of Music on Figueroa. And I had a great bunch of teachers who also taught at SC and at Los Angeles City College. So I went, in actuality, to three schools. I would go hopping, doing classes in each one. And shortly after that, my mother passed away, and I was alone. And I had to go to work to support myself to go to school. So I worked for California Record Distributors, which had all the East Coast jazz and all the West Coast jazz. And that was my big introduction to jazz, just listening to it day after day. And I suddenly realized I'm not going to be a classical pianist, and I'm not going to be a teacher. And I started to play around a little bit. I had a little bit of a background from the Catskill Mountains, from accompanying acts up there when I was 15. But this was the real stuff, hearing these great, great you know, pianists and trumpet players and saxophone players. And then I started working with a guy by the name of Steve Douglas, who was in my bar mitzvah band when we would do bar mitzvahs and weddings. And he said, you know, I graduated school with a guy by the name of Phil Spector. And that's how it all started. He got me on a Phil Spector date. Actually, the first date I did, it was the first time I met Hal Blaine. I think it was Be My Baby. And we'd never met before that. And we did a couple of dates. And then we didn't see each other for a couple of months. And we're both working at the same hotel in Chicago, a place called the Saharan. He was there with Patti Page. And I was there with the Don Randi Trio. And we both ran into each other. We're looking, is that you? Is that you? And it was, we've been friends ever since then. And that's a long time ago.
Let's talk about Hal Blaine. It says in the documentary he used to play in a strip club. Weren't you?
He still plays.
He's still playing. And